We can start with Sandhya.
Good morning, Shubha Sakal. It is an honor and privilege for me to welcome you on behalf of Sun Pharmaceutical Bangladesh Limited for joining today's final session of first E-Space Endoscopy Masterclass. As shared, Dr. Space is the culmination of an endeavor to integrate evidence-based medicine with clinical practice, primarily in the field of hepatology, with most learning points illustrated from the point of view of day-to-day practice. This program promises to be a highly interactive and practice-oriented event. Endoscopy Masterclass is an initiative which is planned to arrange with the objective to help our hepato fraternity for improving their expertise in the field of therapeutic endoscopy. And the support so far we have received from all of you, we believe that we have been able to meet the This program is organized by Sun Pharma in association with the Institute of Gastroenterology and Forum for the Study of the Liver and Bangabandhu Sheikh Mujib Medical University Hepatology Alumni Association, Bangladesh. Sun Pharma successfully conducting different academic initiatives with view to disseminate latest scientific happenings in the medical fraternity globe. And as a meaningful player in healthcare segment of Bangladesh, we have always valued the strong commitment and responsibility to share latest scientific information and knowledge available to us. Reaching people, touching life, based on innovation has been the direction of our journey. It is our great privilege to have Dr. D.N. Reddy, Chairman and Chief of Gastroenterology, AIG Hospital, Hyderabad. Dr. Mohammad Faiz Ahmed Khandokar, Associate Professor, Department of Hepatology, Shahid Suharwardi Medical College and Hospital, Dhaka, Bangladesh, for being today's speaker. I thank Professor Dr. Ghulam Masood, Professor, Head of Department Hepatology, Rajshahi Medical College and Hospital, Rajshahi, and Dr. Alok Kumar Raha, Associate Professor, Head of Department Hepatology, Chittagong Medical College, Hospital, and Dr. Ashraful Alam, Associate Professor, Head of Department, Department of Hepatology. Today, we also have Professor Dr. Amunal Mehta, Chairman, Department of Hepatology, Bangabandhu Sheikh Mujib Medical University. And also thank to Dr. Shaukat Hassan Romail, Assistant Professor, Department of Hepatology, Salimullah Medical College and Midport Hospital, Dhaka, Bangladesh. And Dr. Partho Pratik Roy, Lecturer, Department of Hepatology, Shahid Suharwardi Medical College and Hospital, Dhaka, who will be with us and moderating the entire session. Now, I would like to invite Professor Dr. Mamunal Mehta, Chairman, Department of Hepatology, CSMU Hospital, deliver his keynote.
Thank you very much. I will be brief. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank Asian Institute of Gastroenterology and especially Dr. Reddy for sparing valuable time for collaborating with the Forum for the Study of the Liver Bangladesh and the BSMMU Hepatology Alumni Association in organizing this series of events. This have surely been a great learning experience for the hepatologists of Bangladesh, and I'm also assured that since we also had some contribution in the theoretical part, Indian colleagues have also been able to know our humble efforts in advancing hepatology in this country. I am grateful to Sun Pharma for being a good academic partner as always, helping us in organizing such events. Only yesterday, we celebrated the 49th anniversary of our independence, an independence which was a culminative effort of India and Bangladesh. And it is very satisfying to see that as of today, the collaboration and contribution continues, and it has expanded in different areas, including interventional hepatology. So with these few words, I conclude and hope to enjoy the last session.
Thank you, sir. Now I would like to invite Dr. Ghulam Masood for next proceeding.
Thank you. Can you hear me, please?
You are audible, sir. You can start.
Assalamu alaikum. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. At first, in the month of victory, we should offer the prayers to the soul of the martyred freedom fighters in Bangladesh, and also offer prayers to our colleagues who laid down their life for the COVID infection service in the nation, serving the nation. During the COVID era, most of the academic environment, the academic activities are closed. But hoping news is that some expert learned person from home and abroad come forward to overcome this situation. And particularly Asian Institute of Gastroenterology, they have chosen the right person and the right article, particularly time-honored two-art article like endoscopic management, endotherapy in the liver disease by Dr. D.N. Roy in Hyderabad, and test management of undetectable hepatocellular carcinoma, Dr. Faiz Khandogas. These two topics are both time-honored and demanding in day-to-day practice. Demand of these two subjects is gradually demanding in our practice. So our panelist and expert member, moderator, and audience all will collaborate and all will help to make this program enjoyable and successful. And we also helpful to Sun Pharma Pharmaceutical as the event partner, and they have given us this opportunity to combine or collaborate this program. Thank you. Can you hear? Much.
Roman sir, please. Roman sir.
Okay. Thank you, Professor Ghulam Masood sir, for giving me the floor. Good morning, everybody. I am Dr. Mohammad Shaukat Hussain, Assistant Professor, Department of Hepatology, Sir Solimullah Medical College, Oxford Hospital. Welcome you all in this sunny winter day from Dhaka, Bangladesh, in this ESPACE Endoscopy Masterclass 10th and final session. First of all, I'd like to give thanks Sun Pharma for arranging such a nice and very important endoscopic masterclass program, and also give special thanks to Asian Institute of Gastroenterology, AIG Hospital, Hyderabad, India, and Forum for Study of Liver Disease, Bangladesh, and BSMMU Hepatology Alumni Association. Today, like other previous sessions, today's session will be conducted in two segments. The first segment, there will be two consecutive presentations, followed by a brief question and answer session after each presentation. And later on in the second segment, you will enjoy the live streaming of endoscopic procedures as part of this live endoscopic workshop directly from the endoscopy suite of AIG Hospital. Today, our first presenter, I always think and feel that he shouldn't be introduced before us, because he is the person who actually doesn't require any introduction. He is a very renowned and famous personality, not only in this subcontinent, not only in the Southeast Asian region, but also throughout the world. Yes, he is our most honorable Dr. D. Nageshwar Reddy, sir, currently the chairman and chief of gastroenterology, AIG Hospital, Hyderabad, India, and past president of World Endoscopy Organization. Sir will give his valuable presentation on endotherapy in liver diseases. So without wasting our time, I would like to request Dr. D. Nageshwar Reddy, sir, to start his presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Shaukat Hussain, for this very kind introduction. And before I start, just a few words about this e-space that has been created by Sun Pharma and Asian Institute of Gastroenterology. I'd like to thank Sanjay Basu very much for giving us this opportunity to spread these messages around. I think Sanjay and his team have worked very hard to actually place this in a proper perspective. And to think that we have gone through 10 of these e-space programs is very creditable, both to Basu and the doctors in Bangladesh. Again, this is going to be our final, because 10 is a long period final program before we restart again. I'd like to thank all the doctors in Bangladesh, especially now the study of the Forum for Study of Liver Disease of Bangladesh, for their very kind invitation and for participating in this. And I think as Professor Ghulam Masood said, I think this is a bilateral learning. We're learning from each other. Some of the talks that have been going on from there, we have learned from there. And I'm actually very impressed with what has happened in terms of the development of both gastroenterology and hepatology in Bangladesh. So the last 5 years, there's been a dramatic developments there. And I think they're paralleling developments what is happening in India. And together, we believe that both India and Bangladesh have reached a stage of international levels in terms of gastro and hepatology. And here I'd like to reflect what my friend Mehmoon Al Mahtab said. I think what Mehmoon said is absolutely right, that we are helping each other in this. This is something that is shared knowledge, shared platform, and a shared friendship between both the countries and both of us as gastrohepatologists. I think we have very close relationship. I hope this relationship continues into greater level, that I feel and I believe that we are from the same genetic lines, and we should be together in everything. And our aim should be to become not only level with what is happening internationally, but also achieve things much higher than that, so that people will now from the Western world look both to India and Bangladesh and say, okay, they have done this, let us try and duplicate. So we should reach that level. And I'm sure the way the progression is happening in this field, that together, working together, we'll reach that level. So that's my introduction now. But what I'm going to basically talk is an endoscopy in chronic liver disease patients. And because this forum addresses mostly patients with chronic liver disease, and because endoscopy is a very important form of therapy in many of these patients, I thought I'll give a brief overview of what we do in this area. Now, there are four issues that we have to discuss, two of them in detail, two just peripherally. First is a variceal bleed, because this is the most common problem that both hepatologists and gastroenterologists would see in patients with chronic liver disease and how to deal with that. Second question is regarding role of ERCP in chronic liver disease. I'll go to that a little later to describe issues in this. Briefly, I'll touch on ultrasound EUS guided liver biopsies. And in the earlier demonstrations, twice in the live demonstration, we have shown this, so I won't go into the details. But just to say that EUS guided liver biopsy has now become the standard method of liver biopsy in patients with chronic liver disease for sake of safety and accuracy. And finally, a very exciting area that's coming on now, that is the endoscopic ultrasound-guided vascular therapies. For example, you can do a lot of portal vein cannulations and even tips, endoscopic ultrasound-guided tips now. And this, I think, will become the future for us. So these are very exciting areas. And mostly, I'll be covering the first two. Now, of course, esophageal varices, we know, very easy to treat. We have standards of how the banding should be done. We know about primary prophylaxis, how non-selective beta blockers are used in these cases, sometimes even banding in our countries. But gastric varices, primary prophylaxis and treatment has remained an enigma. And a little briefly on that, should we do primary prophylaxis? So if you have a patient coming to you in Dhaka or Chittagong with gastric fundal varices like this, and this patient, you have never had a bleed. So should we do anything to stop the bleed in these patients coming for the first time, or just leave it alone? There's a lot of controversy here. In India and Bangladesh, we must take a separate view. The reason is most of our patients are coming from distance. They don't have access to medical care. If they have a big bleed in the village with this, then they can die because of this. So I believe personally that primary prophylaxis is something that we should follow. Although if you look at the Bavino recommendations, you will see that they're still saying that further studies are needed. But I believe that based upon the work that has happened in our country and others, that we should have injection of cyanoacrylate glue in these patients. This is a randomized trial done by Shivsharin and his group, published long back, showing that those patients who had cyanoacrylate injection, glue injection as a primary prophylaxis, had less chance of bleed and death than those who are just followed up. We know that in these patients, non-selective beta blockers are not so effective in decreasing the first bleed. And therefore, I think glue is important, at least in our two countries. We should, I believe, firmly use it. Now, when there's an active fundal variceal bleed like this, and of course, here the best type of treatment is to inject glue. Cyanoacrylate glue is available for both of us, now locally made, so it's not so costly. The technique of glue injection, we already demonstrated in the previous live workshops, how we should take the most prominent bulge, feed up near the feeder vessel, and now after injecting, the whole vessel becomes very hard and the bleed stops quite dramatically. So this was actually first started in 1986 by Nip Sohendra, glue injection, and they used to mix lipidol with the glue. Let's see how it is in the, like you can see very clearly here, retained in the gastric varices. For glue injection, I have this rule of eight, which we published along with Roy Petinico in AG newsletter sometime back. We call it the rule of eight. The needle diameter should be 0.8. Needle capacity should be 0.8 ml. The needle length should be 0.8 centimeters. These are very important, that you must take this amount of the catheter volume, 0.8 ml, and maximum volume can inject at one sitting is 8 ml. So this rule of eight becomes very important. So it's easy to remember for you that what should be, because every time somebody asks you a question, you're not sure what type of needle or how much fluid to inject. And so this is rule of eight. Now, one of the problems with the glue injection is potential for this glue to travel from the fundal varices into the pulmonary vessels and produce severe pulmonary thromboembolism. And sometimes it can produce even embolism in the brain and other conditions. So you can see this distant embolism can occur in up to 1% of the patient. This is a danger that we should try and avoid. So how can we avoid this? Of course, technically, there are some tips to avoid this. One is you should not inject the glue very fast. It should be done slowly. At one sitting, you should not inject more than 1 cc. It should be 0.8 cc in each sitting, not more than. And also, at one setting, you should not inject more than 8 cc totally. So you can have 8 injections, but all should be 0.8 cc. That is, if you inject at one sitting large amount, then it tends to migrate. But we have a better method, and this better method is what we are now increasingly using at AAG. This is an ultrasound-guided injection of glue and coil also put together. So we first give coil, that is under ultrasound guidance, we identify the varices, then put in a coil followed by a small amount of glue. Usually when you put a coil, the amount of glue that is required is only about, say, 0.5 ml, not more than that. See, the coil and glue results in less glue being injected, so the embolization chance is very less, and there is a lot of literature now to suggest that you can prevent embolization. The other advantage of endoscopic ultrasound guided intervention, you can directly target the vessel. This is from the esophagus we do this, not from the fundus. So chance of bleed during the procedure is very, very less. And second, we can target the deeper perforator vessels. The cause of recurrence of this varices is because you don't block the deeper vessel, so they can recur again. But using ultrasound guidance and glue, you can actually go to the perforator vessels and block it completely. Therefore, this is the best intervention you can do. But unfortunately, there are two problems. One problem is the cost involved. It's very expensive to have your US, and then second is expertise. You don't have expertise everywhere to do this. But if you have the expertise, if you have an endoscopic ultrasound endoscope, then you must do this as a method in these patients. And this is an example of a large isolated gastric varices, that is IGV1. You can see a Doppler here of the varices very nicely. And after seeing the Doppler, you can see this varix has to be punctured from the stomach. You can have a chance of bleed during the puncture itself, very large. We're also seeing the perforator veins very clearly here. We put in an injection needle, as you can see, the standard 19 gauge needle that we use in the US. And then we put in few coils. You can see the coil just coming out now. Second coil is 12 mm coil. These coils are what the radiologists are using normally for embolization, same coil. And then 3 ml of glue we have injected, small amount in different areas. So there's no flow after the coil. So you can see now we're looking at the flow, and the Doppler shows absolutely no flow. It was very large flow. And immediately you can see when you look at it, it looks okay. But after 4 months, you see how The varex has completely shrunken, and you can see a coil actually protruding out. And all the residual gastric fundal varices have disappeared. And after 9 months, there's total obliteration. So this is a very effective technique that we would suggest that you should. And this study published recently in Endoscopy from a group from Ecuador showed very clearly that combined with glue and coil is much better than just simple glue. So we are now giving up simple glue. We glue coil and glue. You can get very effective obliteration of gastric varices. Single session is sufficient. Patients need not come back to you. Even if they're in a remote village, the chance of bleed from this. There are problems sometimes in, for example, if you do variceal banding of esophageal varices, so we have seen after 1 week or even 10 days, the patient comes with severe post-EVL ulcer bleed. So what should we do in this case? Should we repeat EVL? We cannot because the ulcer is there. Should we do sclerotherapy? It produces more ulceration. Should we inject glue? No, again, not effective. So we didn't have much choice in this case. But now with the introduction of hemospray, a hemospray is usually used for ulcer bleeds. But we have seen that in a post-EVL bleed situation, if hemospray is available in Bangladesh, it's made by Cook Company, if you spray it, immediately the bleed stops. And in fact, this is an example of a post-variceal bleed. With hemospray, you see everything is completely stopped. Bleeding and healing occurs out. Hemospray is also extremely useful in acute variceal bleed. The way it is useful is it causes mechanical tamponade. It causes concentration of the clotting factors, absorption of fluid, activation of the coagulation cascade, and finally hemospray. And these are examples of active fundal bleed. And just putting hemospray, we can stop the bleed immediately. Again, this is an example of acute variceal bleed, and we're putting hemospray to stop. Just again, last year, there's a major paper by Jack Davier and his group from Brussels who showed that using hemospray very early in these patients, you can actually decrease the mortality rate. That is, you do the standard treatment. Patient comes to the emergency in a Bangladesh hospital in the night. There is no expertise, no gastroenterologist available. What you can do is the simple rice tube, you can put in the hemospray in the night. Any doctor can do it, emergency doctor. Next day morning, the bleed would have stopped. Next day morning, the gastroenterologist can come and do a variceal ligation to stop this permanently. And this is an example of an acute bleed. You can, through application of hemospray, can be done through an endoscope or even just simple rice tube also. You apply hemospray and then you can see the bleed has actively stopped, how the bleed is active. Then you can come after 24 hours and 48 hours. You can then tackle these varices in a more definitive way, either by banding or glue injection. And this is a study we published in Gut from the same group showing that those patients who had hemospray followed by definitive treatment compared to those patients who did not have hemospray but only endoscopic treatment, there's a difference in survival. Now, why these patients with hemospray are surviving more is probably because the bleed is less liver ischemia, and therefore, the chance of survival is much higher. So this is what we're advocating now. All emergency bleeds, directly you don't have to do endotherapy. If expertise is available, you can. If it is not, just spray hemospray and then come back with that. Even if this does not control the bleed, what should you do in a case like this with an active bleed? Because we now have what we call these special types of stents. They're called the Danish stents. They're available now. They're very soft nitinol stents which are fully covered. With a balloon at the tip of the stent, you can see here. This is very easy to use. We deploy this in the stomach. And after deploying this, we put a guide wire across and then put the stent. This is a very easy stent to use. We push the balloon up. And once the balloon is pushed, we pull the whole stent back. So it is now snugly against the fundus and the stent is released. Once the stent is released, it compresses the varices completely and bleed stops. Can see how the stent opens up nicely, the bleed completely stops. And then what we do is after 10 days or 14 days, we go in and remove this. And you can see that it's very easy to remove this by a special technique where we actually pull it back into the catheter and then remove. And you can see after removal, the varices are compressed, no longer seen, and definitive treatment. So this is a very effective technique of stopping bleeds. And this is a meta-analysis of all the reports of using for refractory, it's a variceal bleed. And we have found that the success rates reach almost 100%. So what I would suggest again, all hospitals in Bangladesh actively treating patients with the variceal bleeds should have at least one or two stents in the storage. And this stent can be done even by a less experienced endoscopist in the night also. So this stops the bleed to save lives. So I've showed you two or three techniques of stopping acute bleed and then doing a definitive therapy later on. And I think these things we have found at the AIG hospitals, by doing this, we can actually decrease our acute bleed mortality dramatically. Of course, these patients have a limited lifespan unless they get a liver transplant and so on. But at least the acute bleeds can be stopped and mortality decreased. Second, we come to this problem of ERCP in cirrhotic patients. What are the risks and benefits? You can see a cirrhotic patient with ascites like this, varices like this, definitely the ERCP risks are much higher. In general, these patients sometimes require ERCP because of CBD stones, because of bile duct injury, because of malignant obstruction or strictures because of chronic pancreatitis. Sometimes there are specific situations like PSC or autoimmune cholangiopathy. Portal biliopathy is a very common indication with us. And post-transplants, you have stricture, leak, and stone. In all these are indications for ERCP in chronic liver disease. So there is a large bucket of indications. But the problems of ERCP in chronic liver disease is there's an increased bleeding. These patients, when you give sedation, propofol sedation, we can go into hepatic encephalopathy. Infection rates are much higher, and post-ERCP renal shutdown is also. These are things that you have to be very careful, because this was a large database published by Navanithan and his colleagues, and you can see that not only is the post-ERCP pancreatitis incidence increased in cirrhotics when compared to non-cirrhotics, but the ERCP-associated hemorrhage also is markedly increased. This has to be kept in mind. So the risk factors are mainly two, and this is a study that my colleague Nitin Jekta from our hospital published sometime back, and showing clearly that if you have a patient who's in child C or a MELD score of 18, the risk is very, very high, 40% of complication rate. So if you have this group of patients, be careful, don't rush for ERCP, try and give albumin, give coagulation profiles and all that, and then take up for ERCP. The relative risks are with when serum creatinine is high or ascites is very strong or encephalopathy is present. These are also mild risk factors. These are based on a large base of chronic liver disease patients in our institute, over 261 patients, with an adverse event of 16%. So if you have a patient with cirrhosis, you can see very clearly from this study that decompensated cirrhotics have more post-ERCP complications compared to compensated. In fact, if you have a compensated cirrhotic, the ERCP complications are almost similar to normal individuals. You can do it very safely. Decompensated child's B or C, you'll find you have more pancreatitis, hemorrhage. Be careful. And even if you compare alcoholic versus non-alcoholic cirrhosis, you can see for some reason, alcoholic cirrhotics have much higher post-ERCP complications. And one has to be aware of this. So if you have an alcoholic child C cirrhotic with a MELD score of say 19 or 20, the chance of producing a post-ERCP complication like pancreatitis or a bleed in this patient is extremely high, more than 50%. This is what you should do. Second thing is the bleeds that occur in this patient. In addition to pancreatitis, you can get bleeds, and you can again see that those in child C have a 25% of chance when you do a spintrotomy. So how can we avoid this? Of course, this is mainly because of low coagulopathy, low platelets, and portal hypertension. We correct this, we give platelet transfusions, we give vitamin K, and we give terlipressin. In majority of our patients with large esophageal varices where to do a spintrotomy, what I would do is that just before we start ERCP, I would give a shot of terlipressin. That will reduce the portal pressure. If you don't have terlipressin, you can give somatostatin or even octreotide IV just before you start the procedure, so that this decreases the chance of bleed. Also the technique. What I do is, this is a technique that I've perfected now in these patients to prevent bleed. We do like what the surgeons we do. We don't do a direct cutting of the papilla. We do coagulation, wait for a few seconds, and then do endocut. Coagulate, endocut, coagulate, endocut. But using this sequence of coagulation, endocut, we found that you can seal the vessels so that small vessels don't start to bleed. So in your setting, you must put an endocut mode along with coagulation mode and then do this. So this is a technique to prevent bleeds in this case. But bleed occurs in these cases. What we do is we use a balloon to try and stop the bleed. But also, in some of these patients, we don't do a full spintrotomy. We do a small spintrotomy, use a large balloon to dilate the papilla, and then remove the stone. So balloon dilatation is used more often in cirrhotics to prevent bleed. And in case, in spite of all this bleed occurs, very simple. Don't waste your time trying to coagulate. They don't stop. just put in a completely covered metal stent. Put a completely covered metal stent in a post-pintrotomy bleed, the chances of stopping the bleed is almost 100%. And because this is a completely covered metal stent, you can remove this stent after some time. Of course, this is costly, but it's definitely life-saving. In patients with ascites, there are certain problems. There's difficulty in position, difficulty in cannulation, and also increased risk of spontaneous bactal peritonitis. So in these patients with ascites, when you're doing ERCP, always give a very broad antibiotic coverage. Usually we use a combination of cephalosporin with metronidazole combination. These patients, before half an hour before we do the ERCP, we give this injection. Position is going to be difficult, so many of these patients, we do it in supine position or sometimes in lateral position. Prone position is not feasible in majority of them. So the take-home messages from this regarding ERCP are that ERCP has an increased risk in chronic liver disease. The risks are in form of post-ERCP pancreatitis, hemorrhage, infection, as has been shown in the last study that we have published from our institute. They can, of course, they also increase cardiopulmonary risk with anesthetists looking after. But that has to be aware also. To reduce the risk, we use pancreatic stents to decrease post-ERCP pancreatitis in patients. We always use rectal indomethacin in these patients. Almost mandatory to use unless it's a renal failure. We also use papillary balloon dilatation rather than cutting, doing a long cut. We correct the coagulopathy in all these patients. And when we use the cutting, we use alternating coagulation and cutting current to stop them. Antibiotics is a must in all these patients because the risks. And of course, a multidisciplinary approach. Whenever we do an ERCP in these patients, it's an endoscopist, a hepatologist, and also the anesthetists who are talking together to see what can be done. So I covered both these issues in a much larger fashion, but as I said, US guided liver biopsy and US guided vascular therapies are something that is coming up very rapidly. And again, I would advocate that in all centers in Bangladesh, you must now start doing US guided liver biopsy as a primary modality of liver biopsy. Start advocating that. It is a little more expensive than percutaneous, but it's worthwhile in terms of decreased bleeds, accuracy of various biopsying. Of course, vascular therapies. So I can show you all the hepatologists all over that. I think the endoscopy plays a very crucial role in patients with liver disease. And now increasingly, we're realizing that it's very important to stratify these cases into different categories for risk and also to use very judicious endoscopic techniques to try and prevent complications. And of course, it's a teamwork. At the AAG, as you can see, we have a fantastic team of hepatologists, gastroenterologists, anesthetists, endoscopists, of course, pathologists, all working together, then only you get the best results. And I can see this also happening in many centers in Bangladesh. They're all coming together. And I'm sure that over a period of time, we, Bangladesh and India, will be the dominant factor of gastroenterology and hepatology. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Shaukat.
Thank you, sir, for your very nice, elaborate and excellent presentation. I think all the participants here have been very much enriched and enlightened with your presentation because it was very much contemporary and full of information. So now the session is open for question and answer, and I expect a good number of questions from our participants. That's because the endotherapy in liver diseases, there are so many newer techniques and so many newer interventions and upcoming interventions. So I think our participants should have so many questions in their mind.
Questions come in the chat box.
Madam, please.
Any question from our participants or from our expert panelist?
So can I just start initiate by asking how commonly is endoscopic ultrasound guided biopsies being done in Bangladesh. Shaukat?
Sir, actually, endoscopic ultrasound is some extent a delicate procedure, I think. And there are so not so much expertise in our country right now. There are in government setup, there is only one center. My medical college, there is a setup, but still it is not so much common in our country because of lack of expertise. And another thing is there is it is to some extent costly, and that's why still endoscopic ultrasound, the use of endoscopic ultrasound is not so common here. But the days are coming, and the new hepatologist and the upcoming conventional hepatologists are very much interested and enthusiastic with this procedure.
So I think it is very important that you should take it up very aggressively now, because expertise already, I think that's a very simple thing to develop. It takes only a few months to get trained in this. But more important, I think Bangladesh economy is in fact much better than Indian economy now. I think that is the indication that you must introduce more US into various hospitals. And I would suggest that this should be a trust in the hepatology society to try and go more into US-guided liver biopsy and US-guided variceal, gastric variceal treatment. It should become like a first-line treatment. Once you have at least 4 or 5 centers doing that, it becomes very common. Because we have definitely seen from the literature and from our experience that this is much more superior to the standard techniques. This is where I think we should change.
Exactly, sir. Sir, there are questions. The question from Dr. Partha Pratik Roy, he wants to know that how endoscopic ultrasound guided liver biopsy is superior to percutaneous liver biopsy.
This is a very good question, and this has been now some studies are there, randomized trials coming up. There's two major advantages of endoscopic guided liver biopsy. Percutaneous liver biopsy is now done by the radiologists using an ultrasound guidance, and then try and, so when they do an ultrasound guidance and try and get to the area, the accuracy of hitting it is not very good because the needle has to be constantly pointed by the ultrasound. Whereas in endoscopic ultrasound guided biopsy, the endoscopist can very, very clearly guide the needle directly into that specific area. Especially so if it is in the left lobe. In the left lobe of the liver, definitely it's superior to percutaneous biopsy because it's more difficult for the radiologist to reach that. So again, studies have shown that your accuracy rates will reach up to 95-96% in the US compared to say 80-85%. The second advantage of US guided biopsy is regarding post-procedure complications. It has been seen also that post-procedure complications like a bleed, pain and so on are much less. What happens with percutaneous is most of the time they're going to the pleural space. So these patients will have pain that we observed for 6 hours because chance of bleed is very high, compression is not so good. Whereas ultrasound guided, what we do is we take a biopsy and come out and see, we can very clearly see if there's a bleed. If there's a bleed, immediately you can inject some, along the track you can inject substance like fibrin and so on to stop the bleed immediately. We can see it. It's just like laparoscopy sees that we can stop the bleed immediately after the procedure. So for these two reasons, especially because these patients after the procedure can walk off with the US guided without any pain, is much, much superior. Second thing is regarding Anuman Kabir has asked regarding diclofenac instead of indomethacin. Okay, we can use diclofenac suppositories. It has been shown to be as good as indomethacin. Although if indomethacin is available, which is available in our country now, we tend to use indomethacin because most of the studies are with indomethacin. With diclofenac, also studies are there. I think protection is exactly similar. So if you have diclofenac, you can use diclofenac. That was the question also from Sohail, also used the same. Yeah, diclofenac and stuff. And so if you have diclofenac, if you don't have indomethacin, it's still safe to use diclofenac. Then which sedative to be used?
And I think sedatives or anesthetic to be used in the patient's
so, TLD. This is also a very important question. Normally, the safest would be to use propofol in these patients because propofol action is very short. And these patients, if they go into respiratory problem, can be reversed very clearly. Propofol is being also not completely detoxified in the liver, so there is a chance that it doesn't get overaccumulation. Whereas if you use medazolam or any of these benzodiazepine form of sedatives, they tend to act much longer. And in patients with liver failure, they tend to have longer half-life, and therefore this can produce problems. So in patients with liver disease, try and stick to propofol. Propofol given by anesthetist, but if an anesthetist is not there, you can also give small doses. But I would recommend that you have anesthetist with you. Kindly try and not to use benzodiazepines, because they are the ones which can produce, like midazolam and all. They have problems in terms of sedation. I mean, these are very important questions that have been asked. I'd like to compliment the audience for asking such good questions.
Sir, I have two questions to you. First of all, in your presentation, you showed us that we can use hemo spray in case of acute variceal bleeding. Is it applicable in acute gastric variceal bleeding also?
Yes. Chaukat, this is the study from Brazil's Erasme has shown very clearly that in acute gastric variceal bleed also, if you use hemospray, even when the bleed is quite torrential, the hemospray goes to that area and coagulates. It decreases the extent of bleed. So you can use it both for esophageal variceal, but more often it's used with for gastric variceal.
Another question is that in case of type 2 gastroesophageal varices, where there is presence of gastric varices and as well as there is presence of esophageal varices, in this situation, we used to do at first glue injection followed by variceal ligation. But can it be done in single setup, that is coiling with glue injection in the gastric varices with followed by variceal ligation in the esophageal varices?
Again, Shakur, that's a very good, important question. Earlier on, as you say, we used to do first glue, wait, and then do the EVL for esophageal varices. But now we have changed in the same sitting so that you avoid two sedations. In the same sitting, we do both the glue injection along with, if you're doing with the US glue and coil, plus variceal banding. We're doing the same sitting to avoid. So this is the, and when we do variceal banding in these cases, we do sometimes use up to even 12 bands so that we do extensive banding so that the recurrence will not.
Thank you, sir. So, if there is no other questions, I think that so with this question and answer session, we can conclude the first presentation here. So, with this question and answer, the first presentation here come to an end.
Thank you.
Thank you once again, sir.
Thank you.
Now it's time for our second presentation. The second presentation will be given by our the young, dynamic, and the rising interventional hepatologist of Bangladesh, Dr. Fawaz Ahmed Khondokar, sir, Associate Professor, Department of Hepatology, Shohid Sohrawardi Medical College Hospital, Dhaka, Bangladesh. Sir will give his presentation on case in the management of unresectable hepatocellular carcinoma. So now may I request Dr. Mohammad Fawaz Ahmed Khondokar, sir, presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Shaukat, for your kind introduction. Let me share my screen. Is it visible?
Yes, sir. You are visible and also audible.
Okay, thank you. So I've been already introduced. My topic today is case transarterial cable embolization in the management of unresectable hepatocellular carcinoma. So just one day back, it was 16th December, our victory day, and we have stepped into the 50 years of a glorious victory. And I must salute those who fought for our country for the glorious victory. And I also remember our father of the nation, Bangabandhu Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, for leading the independent war and giving us the opportunity to live an independent country. So before going into the details, let's have a brief demography of hepatocellular carcinoma. So hepatocellular carcinoma is the fifth most common cancer in the world and second cause of cancer-related mortality. But unfortunately, 80% of hepatocellular carcinoma occurs in less developed regions. And this is highly prevalent in the Asia-Pacific region and Africa, and also is increasing in Western countries. And we all know that it's a very aggressive tumor, unlike many other solid tumor. In Bangladesh, this is not an exception. And here, hepatocellular carcinoma is also one of the commonest cancers in our country. And the reason is very obvious, because the chronic hepatitis B infection, the prevalence of hepatitis B is, we fall in the intermediate category of hepatitis B prevalent countries among the world. And the prevalence here is 5.4%, although the HCV percentage is low, 0.8%. But also, the non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, which is now recognized as metabolic associated fatty liver disease, is very much common in our country. In a recent study, it has been shown that the prevalence is almost 30%. So MFLD is a growing concern in the world, because it can cause chronic hepatitis, cirrhosis, and to some extent, liver cancer. The cancer registry in our country recently shows that the hepatocellular carcinoma is the fifth commonest solid cancer in our country, and most of the patients are diagnosed in advanced stage like many other countries. So the pathobiology of hepatocellular carcinoma, hepatocellular carcinoma arises from the precursor of chronic hepatitis or cirrhosis. And this happens in almost 80% of cases. That is, in 80% of cases, the HCC which you get is found on the top of cirrhosis of liver. And in less 20% cases, it is non-cirrhotic pathway. And therefore, the treatment, the management policy and the management modalities are different from other solid cancer. Now, if you look at the etiology of hepatocellular carcinoma in Bangladesh, we see that hepatitis B virus is responsible for about 66% cases in one study showed by Mamoon et al. And in another study showed by Goni ABIMS, hepatitis B virus is responsible for 62%. If we look at the world data, we can also see that the hepatitis B virus is responsible for 60% of hepatocellular carcinoma in the Asia and African countries. Now, how hepatocellular carcinoma is diagnosed? So the imaging techniques play a very important role in diagnosis of hepatocellular carcinoma, and sometimes only the contrast imaging CT scan or MRI can confidently diagnose hepatocellular carcinoma without needing for any affinity or biopsy. So the biomarkers, alpha fetoprotein, and sometimes you need to go for affinity or biopsy. So, now, what are the treatment modalities of hepatocellular carcinoma? So although in most of the solid organ cancers, surgery, systemic chemotherapy, and radiotherapy are the three main modalities of treatment, but in hepatocellular carcinoma, systemic chemotherapy, systemic radiotherapy offer no benefit to the patient and sometimes even do harm to the patient. So here, surgery and some local regional interventions are the mainstay of treatment in hepatocellular carcinoma. So in surgery, and sometimes surgery, if it is done in early stage, it becomes curative treatment modality. And in surgery, liver resection in a very early stage of hepatocellular carcinoma, and in early stage of HCC, you can go for liver transplantation. And among the local regional interventions, local ablative therapies like radiofrequency ablation, microwave ablation, chemical ablation with ethanol, and transarterial therapies, among which the TACE is a very important one, and also some development of what TACE nowadays is coming up, TACE step. And tear are also coming up. They also provide benefit to the patient. And systemic therapies can be provided in advanced HCC to some extent. Here, sorafenib, rivaroxaban, and lenvatinib is used, but they can only give survival benefit over 2 to 3 months than the supportive-based care. And in very advanced stage, the terminal stage, you can provide only supportive care to the patient. So during the deciding the treatment which is suitable for the patient in ICC, we must look for some factors like the tumor factors, patient factor, liver function, as because I have already mentioned that 80% of ICC occurs on the top of cirrhosis of liver. Therefore, liver function plays a very important role in choosing the modality of treatment for these patients. And in tumor factors, the size, stage, location, number of the nodules plays a very important role. Also, the vascular invasion plays an important role. And in patient factor, performance status plays a very important role in deciding treatment. Liver function, already I mentioned the child poor score or child poor classification, as well as portal hypertension, plays an important role in deciding treatment. There are several staging systems for HCC, but the BCLC staging system is considered to be the best one because it is the most validated staging system. And here we can see that there are 5 classification or stages: very early stage, intermediate stage, advanced stage, and terminal stage. In very early stage and early stage, the treatment modalities are ablation, resection, transplant. In intermediate stage or BCLC-B, the treatment modality is the chemoembolization, and which confers more than 2.5 years survival benefit. And in advanced stage, I have mentioned that systemic therapy is allocated, and in terminal stage, best supported therapy. Now, what is the role of interventions like locoregional therapy? So in studies, it has been seen that 70 to 80% patients are inoperable at the time of diagnosis due to the underlying cirrhosis or poor hepatic reserve, advanced stage or larger size of the tumor, anatomic location, and the number of tumors, that is multifocal tumor. So among these 70 to 80% inoperable cases, the patients who fall in earlier intermediate stage of PCLC classification, interventional therapies like RFA or TACE can provide cure, potential cure, or at least can control disease progression until definite therapy can be applied. So my today's focus is on image-guided transcatheter tumor therapy, or TACE, which is also known as intra-arterial therapy. So what is the principle of actually the intra-arterial therapy or chemoembolization therapy in hepatocellular carcinoma? So the aim of treatment of TACE or intra-arterial therapies is tumor necrosis. We all know that the liver has got a unique blood supply, that is, it has got two dual vascular supply. One is from hepatic artery and one is from portal venous supply. The portal venous supply, most of the blood, 75 to 80%, whereas hepatic artery supplies only the rest, 20 to 25% of blood supply. But what happens in hepatocellular carcinoma development is that there is intense arterial neoangiogenic activity. And that's why the tumor entirely gets fed by the hepatic arterial supply. That is, the ACC tumor gets its blood supply almost 100% from the hepatic artery. So this difference in vascularization enables selective intravascular delivery of drugs, embolic particles, or radioactive devices to the tumor very selectively without tampering or causing harm to the surrounding liver parenchyma. So if you give the chemo infusion by the hepatic artery, it has been seen that the intratumoral concentration of the drug gets 10 times greater while the normal liver parenchyma is relatively spared. And the drug accumulating in the tumor ultimately kills the tumor cells. And if we further do embolization of the feeding artery supplying the tumor, that happens also the ischemic tumor necrosis, and ultimately the tumor cells get destroyed. So this is the overall the principle of transarterial chemotherapy. The image-guided transcatheter tumor therapy can be of various modalities. One is transarterial chemo infusion. That is, only the chemotherapeutic drug is infused to the hepatic artery to the tumor. Another one is transarterial embolization. That is, only the feeding vessel is embolized without giving any chemotherapeutic agents into the tumor. And next one is transarterial chemoembolization. That is, both the chemo infusion and the embolization is done simultaneously. And further improvement of taste is depth taste. That is, drug eluted bits are manufactured and they are infused to the feeding vessel without giving any embolizing agent. And this drug eluting bits acts as the embolizing agent as well, and also supply the chemotherapeutic agents to the tumor. So these are the different modalities of treatment. But among these modalities of treatment, among TACI and TAE, these procedures were done in the past, initially before the introduction of TACE, they have shown to some extent some objective response, that is, they can reduce the tumor size. But the multiple studies have shown that they could not show any survival benefit. But TACE has shown objective response as well as survival benefit to the patient. And therefore, TACE is nowadays is the most commonly used therapeutic interventions for hepatocellular carcinoma falling in intermediate stage, that is BCLC-B. So here in TACE, chemotherapeutic drugs, mostly we use doxorubicin or cisplatin. We particularly use doxorubicin or epirubicin. An emulsion of doxorubicin with lipidol is prepared and then is injected selectively via the catheter into the feeding artery of the tumor, and which is followed by embolization of the feeding vessel by gelatin sponge particles or PVA. So TACE is not a very recently introduced intervention. It was introduced back in 1980s. And since then, these techniques have been gradually perfected, improving the prognosis of hepatocellular carcinoma. Now the question may come that why lipidol is used, lipidol. Lipidol is actually used because it can prolong the deposition of the chemotherapeutic agents into the tumor. And also it has got the ability to deliver the chemotherapeutic drugs to the tumor cells gradually. And also it is, as because it is radio-opaque, it can be, it helps in visualization of the tumor, visualization of the delivery of the drug supply into the tumor in the fluoroscopy image. And also after the procedure, when we go for a follow-up CT scan, we can easily understand the distribution of the drug. And also lipidol, as because it's a very oily substance and heavy particles, it can provide some temporary embolization to the feeding vessel. And for these reasons, lipidol is a very important agent used in transarterial chemoembolization. What is the TACE outcome? The different data shows that the objective response of transarterial chemoembolization is almost more than 50% of SCC patients. It can significantly delay tumor progression and vascular invasion as well. It can improve the survival, as I have mentioned earlier. In older series, when the patients was not very much selective, the survival benefit was lower, 20 months, but with appropriate patient selection nowadays, the literature shows that the survival benefit is 30 to 40 months, that is about more than 2.5 years to 3.5 years. Now, how do we select patient for transarterial chemoembolization? The indication is BCLC-B. Here, the stage criteria is multilonular or and or large HCC, more than 5 centimeters, absence of cancer-related symptoms, no evidence of vascular invasion or extrahepatic spread, and preserved liver function. And sometimes, so, but the preserved liver function and absence of cancer-related symptoms are very two strict criteria of BCLC-B stage. And therefore, if we can see here the preserved liver function. Here, preserved by preserved liver function, it means that the patient should be of child PO A class and there should be no ascites. And the performance status should be zero, which is very strict criteria in practical area, because very few patients are found to be of intermediate stage having no performance status zero and preserved liver function. And therefore, there is some challenges of BCLC-B stage, particularly. There are some literature for these reasons, although all international guidelines acknowledge BCLC-B for TACE, but however, in a review article published in 2015 in Journal of Hepatology, it has been shown that only 10 to 20% of patients present in concordance with this strict definition of BCLC-B at the time of diagnosis. But in reality, almost 50% of tests is done in BCLC-C states as well. And therefore, ESL guideline in 2018 published, they say that further stratification of patients within each class of BCLC should be explored further. And there are different articles about the limitations of BCLC-B, you can see here. And recently, Hong Kong liver cancer staging system has shown that they have proposed a more granular staging system for hepatocellular carcinoma with improved discriminatory ability. And this staging system actually incorporates many patients who fall actually in the BCLC-C stage, but they fit for the TACE intervention. So the contraindication, absolute contraindication of TACE is if performance status is 2 or more than 2, severe hepatic decompensation, that is child C, extensive tumor burden, macrovascular invasion of the main portal branches of the main portal vein, that is if the segmental branches are invaded or that is thrombosis, TACE can be done, and renal failure is absolute contraindication. And among relative contraindication, portal vein thrombosis and child B cirrhosis. Now, how do we prepare patient for TACE? So TACE is a very minimally invasive procedure. And before patients starting TACE, we check the vitals. We keep the patient for NPO for 4 or 5 hours. And no sedation is actually used during the procedure. And presence of an anesthesiologist is preferable, because if any cardiopulmonary issues arises, anesthesiologist can manage the issues. This is the diagram of the celiac trunk, which is very important. The knowledge of this celiac trunk branches is very important for performing TACE, because sometimes there is some aberrant arterial formation in some norm, in some subject. You can see here the celiac trunk is arising from the T12 and L1 vertebral level. It has got 3 branches. The above one is left gastric artery, and then this is the tortuous splenic artery, and then this was going to the liver, the compound hepatic artery, which give branches, first the gastroduodenal artery, then the 2 branches of hepatic artery, right and left. Now, what is the procedure of TACE? In brief, TACE is performed in a very equipped cath lab, that is the angiographic suite, equipped with digital subtraction angiographic fluoroscope machine. And what we do is first, we clean the right femoral artery to gain the access of the right femoral artery by Seldinger technique. We use the 6 French femoral sheath for this purpose. And then we introduce a 5 French Advantage catheter or Cobra catheter or C2 catheter into the femoral sheath and approach it to the thoracic 12 vertebra and L1 vertebral level to find out the root of the celiac trunk. And reaching there, when we cannulate the celiac trunk, we give some dye, contrast dye, to visualize the branches of the celiac trunk. And once we can identify the common hepatic artery, we introduce the microcatheter, which is more narrower, about 3 French size. And we introduce the microcatheter through the common hepatic artery gradually under the vision of the fluoroscope machine. And once we And then we give some dye to visualize the branches of the hepatic artery and the feeding vessel, which is supplying the tumor. And once we can identify the feeding vessel, we start preparing the chemotherapy, emulsion of the chemotherapeutic agents with the lipidol. Here we use, I have said that we use 50 milligram epirubicin 10 ml and lipidol 10 ml. We make this emulsion properly by mixing these two agents, because lipidol is a very thick, oily substance, and doxorubicin is the aqueous or watery substance. So we mixed these two solutions very frequently. And after the preparation is prepared, we infuse the solution in slowly and intermittently, 2 cc at a time, through a 3 cc syringe via the microcatheter. And after each flush of the emulsion, we give normal saline flush so that the microcatheter doesn't get blocked. And once the whole emulsion is infused, then we embolize the feeding artery by applying gelatin sponge. And this gelatin sponge, we take the scratched spongy foam mixed with 5 cc normal saline in the syringe, and then 2 to 5 cc of that sponge, we inject via the microcatheter, and after that we flush it with normal saline. And after introducing the embolizing agent, we again apply the dye and do the DSA to see whether the vessel is properly blocked or not. So this is the complete procedure of TACE in short. Now, what are the complications of TACE? So post-embolization syndrome, which is characterized by mild fever, nausea, abdominal pain, and fatigue, that can occur and that can last for up to 3 to 7 days. And rarely, you may have liver infection or liver failure. Now, what is the treatment schedule of TACE? So the optimal duration and frequency of TACE, whether it should be done, there are two opinions. One is scheduled TACE versus on-demand TACE. But on-demand TACE is preferable because scheduled TACE sometimes causes deterioration of the liver function, as because most of the cases occurs in the cirrhosis of liver. So TACE should not be repeated. There is no clear-cut on-demand TACE recommendations, but it is thought that a TACE should not be repeated if a substantial necrosis is not achieved after second session or when a subsequent session fails to induce remission at sites that have initially responded to the TACE. And there are some M-RECIST criteria, that is the response criteria in solid tumor, by which after doing a contrast CT scan after 1 month of TACE, we can see whether the patient has complete response, partial response, stable disease, or progressive disease. Now, our experience. Now, I would like to highlight, see you some data of our experiences and to show you some clips how we perform TACE in the cath lab. So, in Bangladesh, actually, the TACE was first. First TACE was performed in April 1 in 2016. And as of now, our team has performed 202 cases so far. And here the image, you can see the cath lab where we perform TACE, transarterial embolization. And here you see the cath lab, we are performing TACE. And here you see the first possible, the right groin is clean. And the local injection lignocaine is being introduced in the right groin. And after that, once the patient is locally anesthetized, we then introduce a needle. And we introduce the femoral sheath, which is 7 francs, into the femoral artery. And through this femoral sheath, actually, we introduce the C2 catheter, which is of 5 francs size. So this is the C2 catheter. And the guide wire is inside the catheter. And everything we do is under the guidance of a guide wire and under the fluoroscopic image. So there is no chance of vascular injury. So in this clip, you can see that the C2 catheter is being approached to the T12 level and under the guidance of the guide wire. We are trying to cannulate the C2 catheter in the ciliar trunk. So this is the level of the T12 and the L1 vertebral intervertebral disc. And once reaching there, cannulating the ciliar trunk, we are flushing the contrast dye. You can see that there is well visualization of the spleen in the branches of the ciliar trunk. So this is the common hepatic artery. This is the gastroduodenal artery. And this is the right gastric artery arising from the common hepatic artery. And this is the hepatic artery proper. And after going into the liver, there is 2 branches, right hepatic artery and the left hepatic artery. And now you can see that we are introducing the microcatheter along with the guide wire into the hepatic artery proper. So the guide wire has gone up, but we are trying to go to the more left, that is into the right hepatic artery territory because the tumor is located in the right hepatic lobe. So once reaching our desired level, we have even a contrast dye to visualize the tumors. You can see here that there is visualization of multiple nodules in the right lobe of the liver because this was a multinodular tumor. And now we are preparing the emulsion of the chemotherapeutic agents. You can see that the first we have taken the lipidol from the glass ampoule, and 10 ml lipidol has been taken. Now the red one is the doxorubicin solution. We are taking the doxorubicin. After that, the emulsion has been prepared. So the two syringes are used by tap channel, and we are pushing the solution forth and back again and again so that the good emulsion is prepared. And once the emulsion is prepared, we are introducing the emulsion slowly and intermittently into the tumor. After that, after the procedure is performed, we are taking the microcatheter first. And then the C2 catheter is being withdrawn. So this is the DSA mode of the angiography. You can see the tumor has been well, this two tumor has been visible very nicely where the drug has been introduced, and finally there is embolization done. And this is another picture of a large tumor where we introduced only the chemotherapeutic drugs, as because this is a large tumor we did not apply the embolizing agent because there is chance of liver failure. So this is an image here. You can see a very small CT angiography, well-defined cyst in the right lobe, and the After the case was performed, you can see the lower bottom picture that the tumor size has been shrunken and the lipidol is visualized. So the survival, this is a recent systemic meta-analysis which is published in Hepatology, where there is seen that the 2-year survival rate is 51% and 5-year survival of cases 32%. This is a very large meta-analysis comprising thousands of patients. And the side effects here show that only the liver and GI abnormalities occurs in 18% of cases. And in fewer cases, fever, abdominal pain, and vomiting is seen. The overall mortality was shown in only 0.6%. So from our experience, we have analyzed some data of 6 months data, where you can see that most of the patients, the size of the tumor was 5 to 10 centimeters, size was 124 cases, more than 10 centimeters, size was 49 cases, and less than 5 centimeters was only 11 cases. And overall, 184 cases were analyzed, and among them, we performed TACE and transarterial chemoinfusion. TACE, overall TACE, we performed in 77 cases, and in 107 cases, we could perform only transarterial chemoinfusion. And these are the demographic data, etiological data. And after 6 months analysis, you can see that this size change was at 6 months. In 49% of cases, the size of the tumor was decreased. And in 36% cases, it was unchanged. And in 19% cases, the tumor size increases. And the survival at 6 months among these patients, we undergone TACE in 77 patients. 51 patients, that is 66% of patients, survived 6 months. And rest of the patients, we are yet to analyze the other data. Hopefully, we'll analyze those data and publish them soon. And this is, you can see here that our first report of its kind from Bangladesh, that is transarterial, the data on transarterial chemoembolization. This article was published in the Eurasian Journal of Hepatogastroenterology in 2019. And Professor Mamunal Mahatab is the first author, and the team members are the co-author, you can see. So this is our some experiences of DACE, which we started in 2016 in Bangladesh. And DEP DACE, you know, this is an advancement of the DACE. Here, Dr. Richard Bits are introduced, but the data so far done has shown that though it is technically very advanced, but the overall survival benefit is not superior to DACE, the data so far shows. And there is another advancement where the infusion of radioactive 131 radio level iodine are introduced, and that is not still done in our country. So I am at the end of my presentation. This is the picture of our team, and Professor Mamunullah Mahtab sir is the head of our team, and Professor Dr. Ashraful Alam, Dr. Lutful Mubin, and me, Dr. Faiz, Dr. Abdul Rahim, and Dr. Sheikh Nurul, Sheikh Mohammed Nur Alam Diu is seen in this image. And so in summary, I would like to see that the local regional intervention therapy is a very important modality of treatment for hepatocellular carcinoma, is because most of the patients present to us in a very advanced stage. And BCLC-B, though, is thought to be the ideal stage for taste of performance, but it should be relocated, it should be more stratified so that more patients could be included for taste of the patients. So thank you for patience hearing. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for your very nice and excellent presentation. And taste is a very delicate procedure, and in the field of interventional hepatology, is a very high-tech and delicate procedure, but you have presented it very nicely and very elaborately, and the presentation was very much clear and easily understandable to us, I think. So now the session is open for question and answer. I'm expecting questions from our participants. If there are any questions from our panelists or from participants. I just want to share with you one, we have a question or queries to you that you mentioned about the criteria selecting patients for TACE. We actually select the patient of BCLC stage B for performing. Is there any scope? As you know that in case of very early HCC, we usually select the patient for resection. Is there any scope of doing TACE in such type of patient in case of very early HCC? What is there any data or for comparison regarding the resection and TACE in case of very early?
That's a good question. So though TACE is reserved for BCLC-B, but it can also be done in earlier HCCs when the resection or liver transplantation is not possible for different regions, particularly if the tumor is located at a location where the radio ablation therapy, radio frequency ablation or surgical resection is not possible. In that case, TACE could be applied. And sometimes if the patient is suitable for liver transplantation, but he's in the waiting list and will need some time for liver transplantation, in that case also we can apply TACE as a bridging therapy for liver transplantation. So these are the other indications of TACE actually.
Thank you, sir. A question has come from Mahmoud Zaman. He has asked about the cost of TACE.
Cost of TACE is actually, it's in our country, our team is performing TACE, and it is, as because most of our patients come from different backgrounds and financially not all are suitable, so it varies. But you have a very comfortable figure of cost for these patients. So cost is not a factor, I think. So
sir, thank you, sir. Another question from Tonmoy Shaha from the side of AIG Hospital. He has asked about if you were present in both lobes, what's the plan of taste in that case?
Well, if the tumor is present in both lobes, so we try to locate the tumor. That is, if the tumor are number of the tumor actually. If these are two tumor isolated located in two lobes, we try to locate them, we try to identify the feeding vessel, we try to identify whether single vessel is supplying both the tumors or different feeding vessel. If it is different feeding vessel, we try to locate them and do taste in a single session. If it is not possible to go more selectively to both the feeding vessels, what you do is we perform transarterial chemo infusion. We only infuse the chemotherapeutic drugs so that both the tumor can get the chemotherapeutic agents. And we postpone the embolization. So this is one. And also another thing you can do, in one lobe you can do RFA. In another lobe you can go for taste, where the tumor size is larger. In that case you can do taste for that larger tumor.
Another question from our learned panelist, Prolok Kumar Raha sir, has just put a question that case of portal vein thrombosis.
Well, first of all, we want to look at why portal vein thrombosis, whether this is tumor invasion or just portal vein thrombosis, benign portal vein thrombosis. If it is tumor invasion, then it actually falls in BCLC-C. And we usually do not perform taste in these patients. But if it is due to only benign portal vein thrombosis, and there are several views on doing taste in patients with portal vein thrombosis. If it is only segmental, involving only the segmental branches, so taste can be performed safely. But if it involves the main portal vein branch, some literature shows that this is a contraindication to taste. But there are some recent papers which show that even in these patients, tests can be performed carefully, even though the main portal vein branch is, there is portal vein thrombosis in main portal branch. So what we do if the portal vein thrombosis is there involving the main portal branch, there we usually do the transarterial chemo infusion. We do not go for the embolization as well. But literatures are now coming up that taste can be performed in that cases also. Therefore, portal vein thrombosis is a relative contraindication of taste. I have shown in my presentation.
Okay. Another question from Dr. Abdullah Al Mahmoud that he has just put two questions to you. First one is, do you have done second session of taste in any patient? And second one is there any survival benefit difference according to etiology?
We have performed several second session of tests in several patients. The number would be around 10 to 15. And the next question is the survival benefit.
Survival benefit
varies from etiology. The literature so far shown that the survival benefit does not actually vary according to the etiology. And so far we have also seen that the etiology factor do not determine the survival benefit. But we have seen that the number of tumors, the child post score, the background bilirubin level, and whether this is a diffuse or multinodular tumor or isolated solitary nodules, these factors actually influence the survival benefit.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir. As there is no other questions, I like to give you thanks again. And we have to conclude the second presentation. Thank you once again, sir.
Thank you also.
Now it's time for the live endoscopic workshop, and it's time for live streaming from the AIG hospital. So I am just inviting Dr. Partha Pratik Roy right now to conduct the second session.
Thank you, Dr. Shaukat, for your excellent session, and thank you to the presenters for their excellent and elaborate presentation. I am Dr. Partha Pratik Roy, hepatologist from Shri Surajah Medical College. Welcoming everyone again, and good morning everyone again. So this is the second session, that is the live workshop of intervention procedures from AIG Hospital, Hyderabad. I will not post much time. Just inviting the AIG teams to join us. Let's start the live. Team of AIG Connectus.
Welcome to AIG Hospitals Hyderabad for the live transmission. Our first case is a middle-aged male with right hypochondric pain with high-grade fever and jaundice. His liver function test revealed a bilirubin of 7 with a direct fraction of 4 with elevated alkaline phosphatase. An ultrasound had shown a dilated common bile duct with a distal CBD calculus. An ERCP was attempted elsewhere where they failed to retrieve the stone. He underwent an EUS which showed a dilated CBD with a calculus. And the plan for the patient is an ERCP with CBD clearance. Over to Dr. Asif for the live transmission.
Good morning, everybody. I am Dr. Asif, consultant and gastroenterologist in AIG Hospitals. So as discussed, this patient has a large CBD calculus in the US. For want of time, I have put in a scope and using a clever cut sphincterotome and a VisiGlide wire, I'm trying to cannulate the CBD. So there are technical issues here. There's a large periampullary diverticulum. I'm just, but the thing is, already little way is clear here, so it's little easy for me to cannulate. You can see that the wire is entering the CBD. Mr. Srinivas, our technician, will be injecting contrast now to delineate the CBD. You can see that the CBD is dilated and there is a large stone lower down.
Dr. Asif, I'm just asking that in this case, there are also the viewers are watching multiple duodenal diverticula. In this case, what is the method of identifying the ampulla, the technique to identify the ampulla, which as there are many paths to go and many ways.
Yeah, actually identification, we have to spend a little time here and see where the ampulla is. Sometimes it gets buried within the diverticulum, sometimes it gets hidden behind. So you need to spend some time, maybe sometimes the cannulation might become difficult, you might use a forceps or a clip to just make it prominent and then cannulate. Sometimes hemoclips are also useful in making it prominent so that we can pull the papilla out and it becomes visible and then Now what we are doing is we are using a stone extraction balloon. So we just try to push the balloon up so that the sphincteroplasty can be done easily, so that it doesn't come in the stone doesn't come in the way of the sphincteroplasty. So now we will be using a Boston Scientific CRE balloon for sphincteroplasty, and how we decide on size is to measure the diameter of the CBD. Please, can you just measure the diameter? So it's almost about 10 mm. The stone breadth is also about 10 mm. So we'll be using not more than 12.5. So this is a Boston Scientific CRE balloon which I'm taking it in through the scope. So we try to keep the balloon in a position so that it is not too inside or too outside appropriately, so that the proper dilatation of the sphincter occurs. So you can see that the balloon is midway. So this is the position which we should attain in CRE dilatation. The balloon is almost midway. We are not using contrast in the balloon, but we have decided we will not go beyond 12.5. There are two issues here. There is a periamplitude diverticulum as well, so we will not be aggressive in doing a CRE dilatation. So we'll be doing it for about 60 seconds. So we have a time here, we keep watching. Once 60 seconds are over, then we can ask our Srinivas to deflate it. So we can see that there is a minimal ooze there coming following dilatation. So we need not worry about it. We can inflate a little bit and give a tamponade so that it stops. Maybe for 30 seconds and then again deflate. Slowly deflate and maybe we can control this bleed. Deflect. So we can see that that ooze is not much now following the tamponade. There is quite adequate dilatation attained now. I will try pausing the stone extraction balloon. So what we do is we try to remove the distalmost stone, just go beyond the stone and then try to pull it along the direction of the CBD. Okay, we are going above the cystic duct. We can see that we are above the cystic duct, trying to pull the stone down. So the wire came out when we tried extracting. We're trying to go in again with the wire. So we are above the cystic duct bifurcation. We are trying to bring that stone which is just sitting at the bifurcation. The stone is actually getting stuck at the cystic duct. That's why we're not able to bring it down. We'll try another time using a different wire. What Mr. Srinivas is trying to do is trying to put the wire in the cystic duct. So it's going into the CBD as usual. Let us try.
Dr. Rasid, let me ask you something.
Yeah.
The first one is, according to the level of the dilatation of the CBD, chance of more complications regarding more dilatation of the CVD, first thing. And the second thing is that how we calculate that with the balloon, how much we can dilate the CVD according to the dilatation of the CVD present in the CVD. Shall I repeat the question?
Yeah, please repeat it.
First one is there any chance of more complication in more dilated CVD? That's the first question. And the second is, how will you calculate that how much you will dilate the CVD in PRCP by working the dilatation, actual dilatation of the CVD?
I think your question is, how do you assess the size of balloon which you are going to use?
Yeah.
So now it is very important for us to understand the morphology of CBD. If morphology of CBD is like cylinder, which is like the upper CBD is as broad as lower CBD, and then you can have, like in this patient, we measured the CBD, and you can see CBD is slightly lesser than the diameter of the scope. So it is around 10 millimeters. So you can go approximately 2.5 millimeter above that, not more than that. So in this patient, if the CBD is 10 mm, I am dilating up till 12.5, not 15. But if CBD is quite dilated up till 12 to 13 millimeters, we can still attempt 15 millimeters. A balloon sphincteroplasty. The second thing very important is that sometimes the lower CBD is very narrow as compared to upper CBD, and then you should not dilate based on upper CBD. It is the lower CBD which will determine the size of balloon, and it is also important to have a time. So you should dilate at least 2 to 3 minutes, because if you dilate it well, you will be able to extract the stone much easily as compared to if you dilate for less time. And if you do not struggle to remove the stone, the chance of post ERCP pancreatitis comes down. So in many studies have been shown that more the time you give for balloon dilatation, maybe 5 minutes, which is too long in my opinion, but if you dilate it for long time, the bleeding rate comes down, the pancreatitis rates comes down, and the size of balloon is determined by the size of lower CBD.
And there was another question was I was asking that is there any more chance of developing complications in more dilated CBD? Is there any relationship between positive relationship between dilation of CBD and chance of
So if you dilate it beyond the lower end of CBD, then yes, there can be perforation, there can be more bleeding. So do not try to dilate too much, but take the help of stone pulverizing techniques. If your balloon sphincteroplasty, if the lower CBD is narrow and you dilate it up till that side and try to remove the stone, but if the stone is not coming out, now we know that we have done the maximum dilatation, we will still be able to remove the stone if we break that stone, either by mechanical lithotripsy or laser guided lithotripsy or extracorporeal shockwave lithotripsy. So once you have done the dilatation to the adequate level, don't over dilate. It may cause more complications. But change the plan to pulverizing technique. So I think in this patient, since the stone is in cystic duct and it is compressing the bile duct, that is why the stone is not coming out. So what we will do is we will try to cannulate the cystic duct and try to remove the stone. But if it is not coming out, then we'll think about plan A, to do a laser lithotripsy, or plan B, to do extracorporeal shockwave lithotripsy.
So, Dr. Asif, that's a good demonstration. We'll move on to another case, interesting case, while you are cannulating the cystic duct. Another case is elderly patient presented with symptoms of obstructive jaundice and weight loss with pain in abdomen. Bilirubin was elevated with total of 17 and direct of 11 with elevated serum alkaline phosphatase. CCT abdomen and PET scan was done for the further evaluation, which showed a carcinoma head of pancreas with duodenal infiltration and encasing SMV GDA with bilateral IHB dilatation. So plan is to do a ERCP with uncovered self-expanding metal stent placement. Over to Dr. Sandeep.
Hi, good morning. Ashraful? Hello? Can you hear me?
Hello?
Partha?
Yeah, you are audible and visible.
Okay, good. So I'm Dr. Sandeep Laktakia from Asian Institute of Gastroenterology. And as you heard the history, this patient has a large pancreatic head mass with obstructive jaundice and with local vascular invasion, which makes him unfit for surgery. The plan is to relieve his jaundice by using a metal stent placement. So while we are talking, I had passed a duodenoscope. As you can see on the screen, patient has got some deformity and the scope position is not very stable. But I could see the papilla. Can you see the papilla there?
Yes.
So that's the papilla. I'm using a sphincterotome, using a guide wire in the sphincterotome to cannulate. A lot of peristalsis is there. Okay, good. Okay. So we passed a guide wire, VisiGlide, into the CBD, which is, I'm not injected any contrast. I'm just following my sphincterotome over the guide wire. Guide wire is quite deep inside the CBD, in the direction of CBD. And once I'm deep in, as my sphincterotome is, can you expand the view, please? Magnify the view. Yes. So the entire scope, yeah. So we'll inject some contrast upper end. So the entire scope tip. That's it. Stop here. And inject, please. That will define my anatomy. I want to get a good roadmap. There comes the contrast. You have the fluoro image there? No dilution. You can see the structure there. It's a pretty long structure. Now you can take a picture. So can you appreciate the long structure from the tip of the sphincterotome till just below the scope? And we'll exchange now a stiffer guide wire, taking out the Terimo wire, giving me a VisiGlide, and then we will place an uncovered, I would prefer a 6 centimeter stent. The reason I am using an uncovered stent is that it will expand but has a less chance of migration. I don't think this patient is fit for surgery, although he'll receive chemotherapy, and if he becomes fit, then surgery can be considered and the stent will also come out with the specimen. But conventionally, for pre-operative drainage, we use a fully covered stent which can easily be removed at the time of surgery. Good, right? I'm exchanging. I've got my sphincterotome back, leaving the guide wire inside, and this one-to-one exchange is very important. So me and my technician, Naresh, we were exchanging the guide wire. And while we are doing it, I would also like to thank our anesthetist who has done such wonderful sedation. That patient is quite sleeping. Thank you. So Dr. Tejas is helping us out. The anesthesia. So all patients are sedated and they're taken with the best care by the senior anesthetist, and that makes the job quite easy. If the patient is restless and fighting with the scope, then procedure becomes difficult. I'm using an evolution stent from Cook, the short wire system. So wire is coming by the side. You can show that device. So it has a little different system of deployment, like a gun. We can focus on the hand of Naresh. It's called an evolution biliary stent. And Naresh will help in deploying the stent. It has several markers. And once he removes the marker and fires the gun, the stent sheath gets withdrawn and the stent gets exposed inside the bile duct. We'll soon see it. So keep a focus on Naresh's hand and the fluoroscopy picture. Here goes the stent, which is inside the covering sheath of the assembly. I go deep inside till the lowermost part is seen. Once I see this yellow and blue mark junction, I'll pull back a little bit to adjust my distal end of the stent. That's most important. So now that I've fixed on visual inspection the lower end of the stent and the upper end of the stent is above the stricture, as you can see in fluoroscopy, I'll ask Naresh to keep deploying. Yes, please. Yeah. That's first part. He removes that, unlocks that. Then we start deploying. This stent is also very good that after certain position, if we need to reposition, stop. If we need to reposition, we can always do that. Just pull back a little bit, pull back a little bit. That's okay. Now you keep doing, keep going. Stop slowly, slowly. Yes, I wanted to keep it here. Slow. You can see on the fluoroscopy, the stent is getting deployed while I'm gradually withdrawing the sheath. Stop. And you can see two markers in the lower end of the stent. The upper of these two markers is from where we can go back again and reconstrain the entire stent. Please go on. Naresh. Do. Very nice. Here we come almost last part. It's okay. There is a stellite now, which we can remove the end of the assembly. As you can see, he's removing in the end. This gets unlocked. Now the stent is completely deployed. I'm still having the guide wire inside, just in case anything else is required. Suppose you feel that the position is not very good, or you want to place a plastic stent through it or another stent, can still be done. I think the position is perfect. And this will relieve his jaundice, and once jaundice becomes normal, he will follow with chemo radiotherapy, and then we can reassess the patient after 3 cycles of chemotherapy if the tumor has regressed in size and does it become fit from the anatomical perspective for the surgery.
Dr. Sandeep, I have a question to you.
Please ask.
How to assess the length of the stent to be used?
That's a very good question. So from the papilla till the mid part of the CBD, generally 4 to 6 centimeters is good enough. So if we divide the CBD into 3 parts, the lower third, the middle third, and the upper third, and depending where the stricture is located, we decide the stent. If it's a lower third stricture, we use 4 centimeters. If it's middle third, we use 6 centimeters. And if it's upper third, 8 centimeters ideal. Having said that, there can be changes depending on the stature of the patient. If the patient is too tall, then the middle third also sometimes can require an 8 centimeter and vice versa. The other way, more accurate way of measuring is you can actually use a scale. So while withdrawing, when the wire is inside and I pull it back, I keep a scale next to it. So from top of the stricture till the ampulla, I have a length measured. This can be done by the tip of the sphincterotome, which is gone over the guide wire. So I keep my tip of the sphincterotome at the top of the stricture and then start pulling back under fluoroscopy to reach your papilla. That's my exact length from the top of the stricture to the papilla. And my stent should at least be a 2 centimeters more than this. 1 centimeter in the distal part beyond the papilla, and 1 centimeter at least above the stricture in the CBD. that, does it answer your question?
Thank you, Dr. Sandeep. Another thing is, do you consider using a plastic stent in case of temporary purpose?
So sometimes we use plastic stents if the jaundice is very less and these stents are expensive. So if the patient is not affordable or has no insurance scheme, then we often put one or two plastic stents to relieve the procedure, to relieve the jaundice, especially for periampullary tumors where the just doing the sphincterotomy, if it's a bulging on the papilla, then that should help.
Thank you.
I think with that, I'm told the time has come to the end of the transmission. Thank you very much for allowing us to present to you. Okay. Thank you, Tejas.
Bye-bye. Thank you, everybody, and thank you from Bangladesh to the AIG team for the nice sessions, excellent sessions for giving us the chance to visualize complicated medical conditions and yes. So there is a question that was related to the previous procedure. Can you answer that? So I
Dr. Sandeep sir.
So there is a risk of pancreatitis can occur if you dilate the sphincter with a balloon, but that risk is very less. More often when we try to grab a stone and pull it down and that gets stuck at the papilla, that causes a higher risk of pancreatitis. So between the two, if a stone is relatively large, it is better to dilate with a balloon and drag the stone down rather than trying not to do that and catching a big stone and that is stuck at the papilla, is definitely going to cause more complications of pancreatitis, bleeding, and perforations. Does that answer your question?
Any other questions from the spectators and panel members? So, as there is no question, I am just asking the panel members to put comments on that. First, I will invite Department of
Your voice is very faint. I'm not able to hear your questions.
No, sir, there is no further question. Is inviting our panelist.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Am I audible? Thank you, Partho. I must thank Dr. Nageshwar Reddy sir for his nice presentation, especially in endotherapy in liver disease. He has nicely presented presented the endotherapy in liver disease, which gives a new insights to us, especially in gastric varices. Yes, the technique that is shown by sir is bile embolization and ultrasonic glue injection, and also bleeding post PL ulcer bleeding, that is hemorrhage spray, is a new technique we have seen today. And also in bleeding gastric varices, he has shown the Denis stain in fundus, and also in refractory variceal bleeding, self-expandable metal stain in stent. And are also nicely presented the risk factor of ERCP in decompensated cirrhosis of liver and Dr. Faiz Khondagar has also given new insights regarding TACE, and we have very much benefited from this good speaker. Thank you very much for your nice presentation, for your that nice presentation. Thank you. And I also have a question to Reddy sir. Before finishing my comments, I want to ask a question to Reddy sir. In case of a small gastric varices with large residual varices, what are the treatment options? Okay.
Thank you very much. I am audible. Am I audible? Hello. Am I audible to everyone? Yes, okay. Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity. Thanks to the Sun Pharma for arranging this series of webinars. I think today is the last one, and which has been so much beneficial for every one of us. And first of all, I'd like to thank Professor Dr. Nagesh Reddy for his usual fantastic slides. This teaches us very important things and enrich our knowledges. And next to Dr. Faiz Ahmad Khandakar, who has nicely presented the case management of HCC, because case is very new concept, although it has been 4 years we are doing case in Bangladesh, and we are the first team to introduce case in Bangladesh. And as transplant is in very early days in our country, hope remains in resection, case, RFA. But TACE is a very important means of treatment of HCC, prolonging the lives, as Faiz Khandakar has clearly shown that there is survival benefits in TACE. So it's very important means as transplant or hepatectomy, partial hepatectomy is very much what I should say, very few centers and very few doctors are doing these things. So TACE will be a very important means to increase the survival in these patients of HCC. So thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Patel, eminent panelists, Dr. Ghulam Mansoor, Dr. Alok Kumar Raha, and Dr. Ashraful Alam, and all our most valuable doctors from Bangladesh. On behalf of Sun Pharma Bangladesh, I would like to extend my sincere gratitude to all of you for your gracious presence, not for only today's the final session of live webinar on eSpace, but all the 10 eSpace webinars. sure all of you would join me in thanking Dr. D.N. Reddy, Dr. Mohammad Faiz Khandokar, and Team AIG for their excellent presentation and demonstration on live procedures. Thanks to Mr. Satya and entire Team AIG to provide us all the technical support for this virtual session. Thanks to Dr. Shaukat Hussain Romer and Dr. Partho Pratik Roy for moderating today's event in a seamless flow. Very special thanks to Professor Dr. Mamunal Mehta Swapnil for his guidance and help in organizing this program, along with Forum for the Study of the Liver and Bangabandhu Sheikh Mujib and Medical College University Hepatology Alumni Association, Bangladesh. I would like to profusely thank on behalf of Sun Pharma all the participants present for gracing this occasion in spite of this challenging time. It was indeed our privilege to have you all here. Also, let me thank you for continuing your confidence in Sun Pharma products and extending their benefits to your patients. Thanks a lot for your great support all this year. Today, on the last day program, I would request all of you to share your feedback and suggestions with Sun Pharma team, as this gives us confidence to organize more such type of program. Thank you. Last but not the least, I would like to extend my sincere gratitude to all my fellow colleagues, a team of very motivated and dedicated assets of Sun Pharma. Thank you, team Sun Pharma. Thanks. Wishing you all a very happy and healthy 2021.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Faiz sir. Thank you, Romal sir. Thank you, Partho sir. Ebong AIG team.
Thank you.
Thank you, all of you. And today is our last session. And thank you for your gracious presence here. And have a good day. I think we can close the.